Yeah. So, shall we get started,
Yes,
Dati?
please go ahead.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Good evening. So, I'm Sri, and my project is, I mean, my paper is mainly about, researching knowledge graphs, like analyzing text and identifying patterns in the form of topics and answering questions. So my main focus in the research is how to derive answers from a body of text, and also how to represent that text in form of topics. So today I'll be taking you through a few very recent explorations in the area of topic modeling, question answering, and knowledge graphs. So let's get started. Let me change the slides. Okay. So I'd like to give a brief introduction about what I have been working on and where I have come till now. So for my project, I have been using a data set that is provided by the National Vulnerability Database, and CVE, which is Common Vulnerabilities, and I think EE and something about vulnerabilities as well. So CVE is a data set that contains standardized formats for a lot of cyber threats in the form of JSON, and it has an API for other formats as well, but JSON is the format that is readily available for open source on GitHub. And NVD is the National Vulnerability Database, which is managed by the government. There's a body that governs cyber threat intelligence. So these two data sets are available in the form of JSON. They have a particular structure which shows the date, the description of the cyber threat when it happened, and what are the there are a few more fields about how to recognize which category it is. And the format that we are using is 5W plus H. Basically, we ask the five questions: what, who, where, when, which, and how. And you can see a small kind of ontology that we are using to identify the questions from a particular story. Whenever you find some story online or a written piece of text, you can apply this ontology to create a knowledge graph and derive answers from that body of text. So this is the hierarchy of concepts that we are mining in the text. So this is a tree graph of taxonomy. We call it taxonomy because it shows the relations between different components, the different concepts that constitute the text, or that constitute the domain actually. So in the cybersecurity domain, you can see we have different players, like an event, party, or a vulnerability at a high level. There are multiple levels going through. Like at the first level, you have a vulnerability, and the second level, you have a component of the vulnerability, database classification, and so on. And at the last level, you have stories. And those stories will be examined in the format of 5W plus H. So this is the architecture that I mean, it's a kind of conceptual description of visual description of how the solution looks like. We take the data from NVD, CVE, and Mitre is another cooperation that also provides data. And we are going to apply the cybersecurity ontology, taxonomy, and the framework understanding with the use of Neo4j and deep learning. And it is going to generate a connected graph, and also it can answer questions based upon the graph and the model, which basically uses BERT. So the knowledge graph, the output is going to be something like this, which is going to be stored in Neo4j database and can be queried upon using something called ciphers, which is called similar to SQL, but for graphs. So coming to identifying the topics, like before going into the graphs, like we need to represent each node with a topic. So that topic modeling is achieved using latent display allocation. It's called LDA. What it does, it basically identifies the words and tries to allocate them to different documents and comes up with the top set of words that represent the document. So having said that, the tools that we are using to achieve this are like Albert is a model that I used for question answering that makes use of BERT. But the limitation of BERT is that it can it need it cannot be extended to a artificial general intelligence way of predicting the making the predictions. So it has like a limited, or it needs to look at both the directions. So that's why they came up with an idea called GPT-2. So let me start it this way. What GPT-2 can do is it has the ability to be extended to a artificial general intelligence instead of like what I mean is that it can do something like completion of a question. Like if you give it a particular chunk of a phrase, it can give you how it can what it thinks about the next words that can come. This graph here shows the number of parameters in millions on the y-axis and the timeline on the x-axis. If you see, it started with AI2's ELMO, which is a ELMO is a kind of embedding actually. It already had 94 million parameters. And GPT, the first model of GPT came around 2018 June, I think. And it had 110 million parameters. From there, it increased to around 1500 million parameters compared to 350 million parameters for Google AI's BERT, BERT Large. BERT again has different, I think, three types of models with the difference in just the number of parameters. I mean the size. In the same way, OpenAI also came up with GPT with different sizes. So these, why am I comparing these models is because they all do similar tasks. Especially, they are used for language. They're called language models because they understand like what are the patterns in natural language, and their ability is in predicting what. Understanding and predicting, generating the natural language. So coming to GPT-2, so before going to GPT-2, I just wanted to have a small discussion about transformers because transformer is the basic building block of most of the language models. So let me take you to those. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. To the right of the screen, if you see the architectural block diagram, this is the transformer model. So it makes use of something called attention. It is a paper that was created by Google in 2017, I guess. It makes use of attention a lot, and it has feed forward networks with normalization and so it has something called encoder and decoder blocks. So what an encoder does is that it's going to map all the inputs. I mean, it's going to train with a specific format. So let me also show you that format. I think it would be better I show it here. Give me a sec. Yeah. Okay, so these are the different variations of GPT. So this is how the transformer looks like. So what the encoder does is it's going to, I think it is better. I show it in the paper itself. Let me just give me a minute while I get you the correct. Yeah. So if you see here, the encoder and decoder are two different blocks. What the encoder does is it's going to represent these blocks in form of it's going to embed them, and those embeddings will be paired along with the positional information. I'm not sure if position information is depicted here, but the x1, x2, x3, x4 inputs here, they are not just words, and along with words that are given as the input, they are also going to have segment representation and also the position representation. Position representation basically means that the word comes in the first position or second position, third position. That information is used to understand like how big the input sentence is, or how big the output can be. So all these details are captured in the at the encoder level while training in BERT. And what decoder does is it takes those representations of the input. It learns those representations, and it tries to predict how it can, fill particular, based upon the previous input, how can it fill the next input. So what GPT-2 does is also somewhat similar, but the difference is in how it is trained. So let us go back to this illustration here. I think yeah, this one. So the main difference, key difference between BERT and GPT is in the in the training itself, like the representation of input. Self-attention is used by BERT, and masked self-attention is used by GPT. So what's the difference between self-attention and masked self-attention? So before going to self-attention, attention is basically a mechanism through which the relative importance of each of those words or those entities are calculated, or they are basically, it says like robot must obey. What attention says is that robo is more important word here, and obey is more important than must, because must is like it doesn't have more semantic meaning. So BERT uses attention without, I mean, even though there is a ability to mask with special symbols like mask, the spelling mask itself inside brackets. In GPT-2, they didn't use those masks at all, like those words at all, to represent to provide in the input. That means the future input is totally removed from training, and now GPT-2's task is to identify like what can it fill up, how can it come up with the with that next word. And as you might have guessed, it is really hard to come up with that, and that makes GPT-2 really parameter hungry. It has so many parameters just to understand this relation between between the input and the output. So I don't think we have the information here. Let me take you back to the PowerPoint presentation. Okay, so this is the architecture for the transformer. So at each level, you can see for in the encoder, we have a normalization feed forward and attention block. And with those attention blocks, the decoder is going to learn how to predict the next word. So now the same, okay, why did we have to use attention? Because when we used LSTM or GRU or any other sequential blocks, it was very computationally heavy, and also we could not get more bandwidth, as in we need to go in a sequential manner. So there is an information bottleneck where you can see only last, output of the last layer or the last cell. But in the case of attention, that's not the case. You can see all the If you look at this paper here, you can see all the inputs at once, and also the decoder can see all the representations, intermediate representations at once. That information is going to be useful when it is predicting the next word or any other output. So having this power of the transformer, GPT went one step ahead and tried to use it to So now whatever the input is predicted by GPT-2, whatever the output is predicted by GPT-2, that is also given as the input again, and it uses the combined input to predict the next output. And one other difference between GPT-2 and BERT is that the type of encoding used by GPT-2 is called byte pair encoding. So now what is byte pair encoding? BERT used tokenized words, and it used the words themselves to make a language representation. But what GPT-2 people figured out is that if a model can understand that older is a past tense of old, I mean, sorry, is a degree of old, and oldest is a superlative degree. When the same model looks at something called smarter, it should also understand that it is related in the same way as older is to old. It should understand that smarter is to smart in the same way as older is to old. So this kind of pattern in language understanding can be represented by dividing or breaking the word into multiple chunks and using those chunks as the basic blocks to represent the language itself. So this way of breaking the words and using them for representing the language model is called byte pair encoding. I am not sure like where the word came from, but I think it's because we are mostly like breaking them into two words and it's a pair. So if you see, for example, the input here, I'm sorry. So the input here goes something like this: low and lower are like byte pairs, and newest, wildest are going to be trained, learned by the model. And here the major important addition is the slash w, like the separation character, which is very important because the model has to understand that this I need to use the separation character not just to identify words but also to identify a more granular in level of understanding for the language. And can you think about like where did this idea come? I mean, how did the researchers think about this idea? So basically what I'm asking is like, if you were researching on BERT and you wanted to improve BERT, would you have come up with this idea? And if you came up with this idea, on what lines would you have thought about? So it basically boils down to at a high level, there are two types of categories of representations. One is like character level encoding, the other is word level encoding. But both were not a great fit, or I'm not sure if the researchers really researched upon this and came to this conclusion, but character level was too low, like very granular, and it didn't have any semantic meaning. And word level had semantic meaning, but it was it could not like incorporate all the nuances or all the details of the language. So that made the researchers think about what is the middle ground, and they came up with this idea to break the word and identify what's and see like if it works out. Okay, having done that, So mass self-attention also helps us. Like, let me now explain you why did we have to use mass self-attention and why is that important for the performance of GPT-2? Because if you see the difference between GPT-2 and BERT is not much. It only uses transformer decoder blocks, because in transformer, as you have seen, there are both encoder and decoder blocks. But in GPT-2, there are only decoder blocks. So can you see the difference here? On the right side, you can see at the input, they have encoder, encoder, and encoder. Like, BERT has only encoder blocks because it has the representations. It outputs the representations. And GPT-2, we have only decoder blocks, which is a part of the transformer. A transformer is basically a combination of both encoder and decoder blocks. So why did GPT-2 use only decoder blocks and why did BERT use only encoder blocks? BERT uses encoder blocks because it also has the position information. It is using positional information, even though it is not looking at the future word, like otherwise it would not be causal. But it still has some information about, like, there is something. I don't know what it is, but there is something. In case of GPT-2, it doesn't have any information of that sort. So that gives a little more power to GPT-2, but at the same time, it needs to be trained with much more parameters, like a lot more parameters than BERT. That's why it has a lot bigger size. So, okay, so now GPT-2 can do something like this. When you give the first line as the input, so it can give the all the from the second to the last lines, it can give as the output, but BERT cannot do this because it is limited by, it is going to fill up the space that is remaining, but not gonna generate something new. So GPT-2 is used as a natural language generation model, and so if they did not stop at GPT-2, they train it on many different kinds of data sets and different tasks. One of them is translation. You can see, like, it can really be extended to any kind of application, like translation, summarization, question answering. Even though BERT is still performing a lot better at question answering, GPT-2 also can do, so this is the kind of representation I was talking about. The first layer, it looks at the tokens. This is the BERT model. The first layer, if the input is the top layer, below the line, you can see the token embeddings and sentence embeddings. You can also call them like slices of tokens. Each sentence. And positional embedding is basically like which position it is in. It shows like how far it is from the beginning. So this BERT is also used on multiple different tasks for both question answering, entity identification, NER, and so many. The question answering makes use of something called Squad Dataset. It is a Stanford question answering dataset. It is a curated dataset of, I think, some 1 to 2 million questions since past 4 to 5 years, I guess. So that is something about GPT-2. This is a very good resource where it is called the Illustrated GPT-2, where the author has, even though it is just a paper, like I did not understand much about reading from the paper, but here, like, the author tries to turn it into a set of visualizations which we can really follow along, and from here it goes much deeper into the calculations, the mathematical calculations about how the attention is actually calculated, and it takes this example of how much of attention each of word is receiving. To keep the current session short, I don't want to go into all the details. But before getting out of GPT-2, let me also touch upon what data set they have used. And what are the difference? What are the precautions, if I can say, did they take about the data set? So we know that like GPT-2 is really great at creating stories. And I mean, after if you had reviewed a few achievements of GPT-2, you might have come across something like it has fooled people into believing that it wrote a paper. I think it's GPT-3, but both are really similar. There are very, very small architectural changes. The paper that was published by GPT-3 or written by GPT-3 has completely fooled a few humans. So how did it get such a level of understanding or such a level of masquerading, you know, techniques or tricks up its sleeve? I think it also has something to do with the data set, because the data set that is used for GPT-2 was a curated book corpus of 800 million words. That is a project that was created to make children books available for everyone online, and also Wikipedia with 2,500 million words. But there was a proposal to use a common crawl dataset, but just crawling the whole web would be it is like there is not much quality that you can assure about like crawling, you know, without a proper what do you call it, like quality measure. So what they did is GPT-2 authors, they scraped the text of all the links that they could find in Reddit. And because they follow a particular topic, and all the links that are going to be in that discussion are most probably related to that topic. And also they considered only those links which received at least 3 karma. Karma is like those points that you get on Reddit to if someone validates you, like someone has to some actual human has to upvote on your link or your response to say that it is actually something meaningful. So they took a lot of measures to make sure the dataset is really good. It's not something random. So also, one of the important things is that they scraped web pages which have been curated and filtered by humans. So they involved humans a lot in the dataset curation. And also, the scraping itself, the initial measure itself was to make sure that, because nowadays we can find a lot of content on a web page. Reddit is like, even though it focuses on large, long conversations, it is much more rich in textual content than Twitter, because Twitter is like all conversations, they are very small, and we may not find all the relevant content in Twitter. Also, Twitter is known for its shorthand notations, which is not actual language. It is like people are accommodating themselves to, you know, make sure that they do not cross the limit. So I think Reddit is a better alternative for Twitter, given all these you know, nuances. And the dataset that they curated is like 40 GB of text. It looks like not much, right? Like given the amount of parameters, I think 1500 million parameters were trained on 40 GB of text. And there were over 8 million documents. There were no duplicates. I'm not sure why they did that. Maybe I'm not sure how it's gonna affect the training, but yeah, they decided to deduplicate, and they removed all Wikipedia documents, because anyway, the Wikipedia documents are already being considered from Wikipedia. So like we discussed before, byte pair encoding, it gives more granular level understanding. And then they decided to come up with different sizes. So here you can see that the base size has around in million parameters, I think. BERT large has 345 million parameters, and GPT-2 has 1500 million parameters. And the level of accuracy that they got on, these are different metrics, MRPC and SST2. They evaluated that with, this is for BERT actually, and they evaluated the same for GPT-2 as well. These are the data sets that they used. They compared it with state of art. This given 1500 million parameters, this is the performance of GPT-2, and 345 million parameters given the performance of BERT. So there are a few data sets where GPT-2 didn't perform very well. As you can see here, it only gave, I think, 8.63. I think the level of accuracy is too less. I think it's a PPL score, it's not accuracy. So, but still, apart from, even on Wikitext 2, it didn't perform as well. I think I'm guessing like the lower score is better. So if you look at the level of accuracy in Lambda dataset, it is a dataset that has like, that is being used mostly for like the word center. It has a few constraints on how big the sentences can be. So that it makes more sense for a human to understand and reason about it. And GPT-2 passes something called a children's book test. So what this actually means is, because language models cannot be totally, evaluated based upon one metric, like one score, they have something like this called children book test. And it needs to, so if you see question answering on children book test on papers with code, you can see other models have an average very less, and GPT-2 has the highest. So it is given like the data set has a collection of books written for children by all the authors since whatever time available. It is freely available with the name of project called Project Gutenberg. So because it has simple to understand terms, it does not have any domain level information. This data set is more suited to evaluate language models, which does not depend on any, difference in meanings between words. Like, it does not have any domain level data. So that is the reason they used it to evaluate GPT-2. I think this was some other challenge. So I just added these so that we have a full level understanding. What GPT-2 does is like the applications of GPT-2 are really, really huge. Starting with text summarization. So the text summarization basically means you give it a large document and you ask it to identify like what is the gist of that document. So this performed very well on the news dataset, which was collected from CNN and Daily Mail. So what this data set probably has is all the news content, and it is asked to summarize based upon like give a headline to that, or TLDR, basically like too long, didn't read. It's a kind of a shorthand notation. So they try to use the Rogue F1 score to evaluate like GPT-2 and other state of the art models. So it seems like GPT has decent level of, I mean, compared to others, it has a lower score, I think, which is better for the score. Basically, if you look at the, you know, few demonstrations of GPT-2 online, you would be like pretty much amazed about what it can do. Let me take you through one such example that shows. This is an accompanying blog for GPT-2, which kind of tries to explain something that is written already in the paper, but in a little more interactive fashion. So now, like here, you can see how it compares to the human level on different datasets, like the same dataset that we saw here. Especially on children's book test, it comparatively, like the 93% is too high compared to 96%, which is human level understanding. So this is where the GPT-2 shine very much, and then with a very few changes, it GPT-3 was released, and GPT-3 is a much bigger model. It was released very recently, that's why I didn't have it in the graph. But I do have the changes, the variations that GPT-3 has compared to GPT-2. Let me take you there. Okay, I also wanted to talk about like feature extraction, but yeah. So where did I add it? Okay, so the differences were like the number of parameters have been increased a lot. So they increased it by 10 times from GPT-1. GPT-2 has like 10 times the parameters. And then GPT-3 had even more parameters. GPT-2 is 1.5 billion. But GPT-3, you know, goes from to a much more level. Like I think it is, I think 12 billion parameters. GPT-3 has 12 billion, which is like not even comparable to any other model that we have on this chat. So because it has such a big, you know, such a big parametric. Size, it is not efficient to run the model on any other infrastructure apart from OpenAI's or entrepreneurial landscape. But we can, there is an option to subscribe to the API and try out the model's abilities. So coming to GPT-3, it uses the same architecture, but with a bigger embedding size. It uses 12,888 size for embedding compared to 1,600 for GPT-2. And also has a large space for fitting. So this is a project that was created by GPT-3 with the use of GPT-3 called DALL-E. So what this does, this is trained based on both text and pixel data. So if you see, okay, I don't have that here, but the input for the embeddings is going to be both. The only change is that half of the input is going to be text and the other half is going to be the pixel data. And what it came up with is, it's a logical progression to text and visual understanding. So if you looked at all the models that came till now, they kind of predicted text based upon the input text, or they predicted image based upon the past image input. But where this model differs from those models is that this predicts image based upon the past text. So here, this is the text prompt that is given as the input to GPT-3, and the output is the images that are generated by the AI. So the inputs, here they gave us a kind of playground that we can change the inputs, but the annotation is done in such a way that it is looking at specific kinds of inputs, you can say. I can change my text from, hey, GPT-3, give me an illustration, a list of illustrations of a baby daikon radish in a tutu walking a dog. So that gives this output. Whereas if I change that to, let's say, Pikachu, everything is going to be like, the other inputs are going to be same, but the GPT tries to change the first. It basically, what it means is that it understands what is radish and what is Pikachu and what are the differences between them and how I can mix and match between that visually from the text, like how I can map that text to a visual pixel data. So I can change this into something like that. So even though you're looking at, because the interface is made in such a way that I'm able to change them from the drop down, but this is not limited to these options here. You can virtually say anything that comes to your mind and it'll still give the results. So that is at least the claim of the authors. And as you can see here, these results, you cannot assume that they are found somewhere on the internet, right? And also, one more, yeah, this one. So there is no coffee shop with name OpenAI. I'm not sure if there is, or even if there is, I'm not sure it has in such a format in the world. But what GPT-3 did is, because it has the information of both text and pixels, it kind of manipulated, I guess. It looks like it kind of figured out how to use that pixel data to, understand the text and transform that information into a visual representation. So, coming to the architecture part, is entirely same. Only the only difference is the number of parameters and the size of embedding. So with that, I'd like to jump to would you have any questions? Like, maybe I'll take the questions after done with the presentation. I have one from Dui. So he says, like, what do you think is the specialized role of GPT-2 and BERT in general? Why would you prefer one or other? So if I understand the question correctly, I think GPT-2 and BERT are, they are called language models for the reason they understand, the language representation, and they can be used to predict or generate something using natural language. But the difference is, like, why would I prefer GPT-2 or BERT, and why would I prefer BERT or GPT, is that GPT is kind of a progression from BERT towards artificial general intelligence, whereas in it does not, it has the ability to come up with new concepts, or it can create something out of nothing. But BERT does not have that ability, because so what I mean here is that when you give GPT-2 a sentence, it can fill that, but you don't have to say anything like when to stop, when not to stop. But for BERT, you'll have to mention, like, okay, I need you to fill in the blank, or I need you to choose from this set of options that I have. It's more like, think of it as GPT-2 can write a subjective question, like subjective exam, whereas BERT can write only multiple questions, MCQ based exam or fill in the blanks based exam. So if that was clear enough. So I'd like to stop here.
What is the what is the reason to go to one side of the mother? For example, auto in Coro, we have an in Coro side, we have a decoro side, so
Yeah.
opportunity mapping between input to the output, right? But
Yes,
if
certainly.
you claim that BERT is based on the encoder side and the GPT-3 or 2 is mainly based on decoder side,
Yeah.
and then transformer is actually handled about the both side,
Both
right? And
sides,
the
yeah.
original thing.
Yeah.
So what do you think why they are choosing only one side? Because they
Yeah.
try to emphasize in the generation side first or
Exactly. I think yeah, the reason is being the transformer is a block that matches the input to the representation and tries to predict something that is a possibility of what is missing in the input. So what BERT does is it takes that idea and it is going to stop at the input representation level. Like it is only going to give you the representation of what it learned from the language or the input that we gave or to train. But what decoder does is the decoder has the ability to take that representation and generate something new. Like it is going to fill something in the future, having observed all the causal relationships in the input. So
But why not both? Why not
so
BERT plus GPT?
I
So
mean if you are going to use an encoder, you'll have to I think I'm not sure if that is going to help much because encoder is going to have the positional information along with the inputs that you are giving, the word level representations. And that is something we wanted to avoid because we wanted it to come we wanted the GPT-2 to come up with something by itself instead of knowing about what can be in the future. Or even though we cannot call it actually future per se,
Yeah,
we
but
did not.
they know about all the information because pre-trained model is really big, and then their learning is the scope is big.
Yeah.
But how about I want to customize of the maybe GPT model so I can working for the maybe special domain like a medical or maybe business or education. Do you think the tuning is can be done through the GPT?
Actually, I didn't come across any tuning level specification. GPT-2 has been like trained by a lot of other places apart from just like story generation or natural language question answering. Like they try to come up with some domain specific applications as well. The main what is it? Challenge behind customizing GPT basically lies in curating the data. I think because it has a lot of parameters, if we do not have enough data, it is not going to train well. Like it may very well be underfitting, or I think it is going to underfit.
So yeah, GPT-3 claimed that they don't need any training anymore because they already
Yeah.
know about everything. So this is the social learning or future learning approach.
Yeah, that is
We
one
have
of
to
the key.
mapping to the specific domain without the training. But sometimes you have to customize the general knowledge to the my own domain. So customization is not happening. Even sentence or image can be generated in different manner. Like for example, I want to generate your image for the Asian versus the maybe African American, right?
Yeah.
Maybe a different way to present it. But right
Yeah.
now they make it maybe general image.
Yeah, I think
So
yeah.
how can you customize?
GPT-3, I'm not even sure like they can make it possible because given the size and scale. What I'm thinking is like because the one of the main appreciations that GPT has got is that it is really good at zero-shot learning. Like it doesn't need much data. Maybe if you kind of provide a small set of data and kind of use a transfer learning to to generate a smaller model. And I'm just guessing this can be a possibility, but I didn't come across anyone trying that out yet. But it would be a very good use case to try out and see if I can really, make it useful for like because most of the enterprise they need data. They have data that they don't want to be public or not even on the internet or anywhere else.
Okay. But right now, API is available for everybody, or you still have to go through registration-based API.
I mean, it's not available for everybody, luckily. Like, it
Right. They
takes
are
a
waiting
long
list
time.
and then they are still waiting.
Yeah, there is a long queue for getting the access. And their main idea is to make it monetize the model, and because it takes a lot of energy to run the model.
I see.
So yeah, they're trying
It's
to
too big,
monetize it and
right?
get,
To deploy to the anyone else, no one can handle that big model.
yeah, so that's the reason they're trying to fill out some costs from running the data. I think just 1 hour of running the data is somewhere around like tens, if not thousands of dollars.
Okay, so you understand now about the GPT-3, so they know about the both image and the text. So I can generate
No.
some of the image, or I can generate the text out of the image. It can be interchangeable.
I mean, one of the architectures called DALL-E, it's like, yeah, actually they didn't give exact architecture. They did not provide it publicly. That's the reason we are not sure if they're using only GPT-3 in the backend or they have something else. But what they describe is that it is a GPT-3 model itself, but the data set is a text image pair. So from
But they
the fr
use anything like a scan model to generate the image in dynamically?
no,
They don't.
they used only GPT, like predictive model, not a adversarial model.
That means that no dynamic generation. For example, this is open AI, right? But
Yeah.
you don't put this from UNKC AI.
Yeah, I mean that we can
That part
change.
can be changed. Okay.
Yeah, this part can be changed. They did not. I think these are evaluated results, because they didn't want to maybe take the load of hitting the model all the time. They gave a short closed loop options, but if we have the access, this can be anything. Like we can give our own text here, and that will come up with
Okay,
that
sure.
text.
Yeah, I think they're just afraid that people will overload the model, but pretty cool. I've been trying out when you were presenting it. Damn,
Yeah.
how much, capability that the model is able to generate. We're not worried about, even worried about, having copyrighted issues. When we can just, if we want to put something in the PowerPoint, for example, like visualization, we can just tell the model to make one. So we don't have to copy
That'd be
anything.
cool.
The model can just go ahead and do that. And yeah, we can use that in our PowerPoint without
So, for
worrying.
example, we are teaching the CBPR image generation of the architecture, right? They can learn about all the architecture from the CBPR paper. And I want to draw some of the architecture so machine can
Something
do
like that.
it.
Yep. Yeah. We can just describe everything in text, and then the model can just generate that nicely in a conference standard paper format. Something like that. So that could.
Even the writing paper.
Yeah.
The
You can just talk
paper,
everything. Yeah.
yeah, robot can write paper for us.
Yeah, it already happened with GPT-3 directly. Like it published a paper in a conference, and
Yeah, accepted by the company. I think Adita has a question.
Oh yeah, sorry, let me check that. So Aditya says, can you explain more about how prediction is getting performed for word or character? Which model for this prediction? So if I understand correctly, Aditya, please correct me if I'm not right. So you're asking how to touch more upon like how character-based prediction models work and word-based prediction models work, and which model for this prediction? Okay, am I right?
Yes.
Okay, so BERT basically has a word-level inputs, like the So word and character level are basically called embeddings. Before you can train a language model, you need to convert the text, like because computers can only understand numbers, it all the characters or text needs to be converted into numbers before training the model. So for example, the basic representations can be like word to vec, tf idf, and basically count vectorizer or something like that. So those are very basic, right? But if you had seen some LSTM model, the basic LSTM model started with predicting next what could be the next character. Like, let's say if I write MANG, can you guess like what am I going to write next? Like, what could be the next character? It's mostly going to be based upon if you know about my dictionary, like, or the English dictionary, it can be it basically depends on the data that you have. So this is captured, like the frequency, basically how did the computer come to know about the next character could be O is based upon how many times it saw that in the input and how many times did it adjust its weights based upon the gradients that it saw while training. So character level is not good because you can make sense of each character, right? M doesn't have any meaning by itself, whereas man, man can have some meaning, and go can have some meaning. So what BERT does is it treats mango as one entity, as in it represents some number. For let's say mango is 3.5. In case of BERT, it is going to treat the whole mango as one entity and gonna assign one number, or to be more precise, some vector which has some number of digits, some dimensions, right? But what GPT-2 does is it is going to break this into two parts at least, and those are going to be going to have separate meaning, and this in this case they do not have the exact meaning that corresponds to the word mango, but like I said, like if you say old and older, these can be split into two parts, old and er. And what it's going to see is that the same er is also going to be repeated when it says newer, right? So now if it has a representation for new and er, so it can have some semantic understanding about where er is used. So for example, you might have seen people or children when they learn about present and past tense, you can see that for proper tense there are not improper tense as well. So for hit, it is the past tense is going to be hit, but sometimes children say I hitted him. Like, where did they learn this Edward? How did they know they had to add ed? Because they might have heard some adults saying like I realized, or I traveled, so they identified this pattern from listening to so many people talking to each other. Whenever they are talking about something in the past, they are most likely to use some word that ends in ed. So this level of semantic understanding was possible with the GPT-2 because they use something called what is that? Let me try to see. I forgot. Byte pair encoding, BPE. So this is a kind of encoding. This is a kind of intelligent idea that, clever idea that the others came up with. And that worked out pretty well for GPT-2. And maybe there are a few more kinds of, embeddings that if we can come up with that work even better, and we can create a model which is much better than GPT with smaller number of parameters. So it is kind of experimentation. That's what makes it a very exciting field of research.
So GPT-2 is the best for right now for the
GPT-3 is a even better model, but given the size of GPT-3 is not available for the public. You cannot get the code for GPT-3, but for GPT-2, yeah, I think for GPT-1 you can. I'm not sure about GPT-2 as well. But once you get one GPT-1 at least, you can. I think the changes are only to the architecture, like the number of representation length and the number of parameters. So I think if you have a big enough machine, you can easily scale it up to GPT-2 and GPT-3.
Do we use the GPT-2 for the hackathon competition?
Yeah.
The time you're able to get the code or just the API?
Dewey, I think
Dewey is in
the question is to you.
Are you asking me?
Yes.
Yeah. I use a variation of the GPT-2. Yeah, I did.
What is available? Model is available, code is available, data is available. What is available?
The model itself, you know, it's already trained on a robust conversation mm-hmm. data set. So they released the model on a framework called Hugging Face. Mm-hmm. So you can just, you know, use the, they have some sample code in Colab notebook for you to use mm-hmm. as well. So mm-hmm. you can just run the notebook and ask some random questions like, what is the meaning of life, or and then how are you today, and then what is life? You can actually, you know, talk just random things, and then mm-hmm. it will try to answer in like a human way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a Hugging Face framework.
Yeah.
GPT-2 available, and then
yeah.
Not only GPT-2, it's going to have like a bunch of other very
bunch of things.
So GPT-2 and BERT is like the very standard model. Mm-hmm. And then they have some tiny BERT. And then they have Roberta. They have some more, you know, like mine is DialogPT. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's GPT. So it's just trained on a very specialized data set on the conversation. Yeah.
Okay.
So they have all sorts of different models there. You can try, you know, whatever is suitable for your research first.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, this is a example application that Hugging Face created with GPT-2. Mm-hmm. They use GPT-2 to create this, and you can write any sentence here, like Kansas City is the best place to live on earth, and you can say autocomplete.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see what it comes up with. Okay. It just came up with a comma. Yeah, so
usually what are you expecting? This transformer can generate some additional statement.
Yeah, they gave a specific input, like
mm-hmm.
It is giving only one. I think this is a word completion, but I think GPT-3 can do full mm-hmm. article completion.
Okay, I see. So they're helping me to complete the article.
Yeah.
In Kansas City.
Let me try to see this.
They will put some of the
It just gave the, I think,
okay.
I think it is.
How about if you put the empty to the Kansas City instead of Kansas City, can you put something empty and say there is the best place to live?
I think it is going to like autocomplete, like post complete. It's going to complete after we write.
It cannot do that in the post.
Yeah, it cannot do in the beginning. It can do at the end.
Where is the best place to live on the earth?
Okay.
If you put that one, they'll answer.
I'm not sure if it does. Maybe it will. So here it says planet. Like, let me add that as well. What is the best on the planet? Okay. I mean, given the nature of this application, it is going to just say what word can come next, mm-hmm. and it's not a question answering model. Yeah, it kind of identified that it needs to. Have a space.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can go to the word by word prediction. What can be?
Yeah. So, but GPT-2 is not very good at this, I think. The answer might, oh, it got something from article, I think.
I see.
That's, okay. It kind of feels like it knows some philosophy.
Okay, I see.
So, yeah, so that is about, like, Hugging Face has a lot of resources for the models.
Mm-hmm.
Even like with the code examples, you can see here, I think. For GPT-2 also they have. And I wanted to touch upon this something called Albert that I used for question answering.
Mm-hmm.
Albert uses BERT, but it is a it got the award for best parameter washing machine. That means if BERT has 350 million parameters, it just washed all of them away, and just even with 18 million parameters, it was able to give a very good performance on question answering. That is because others have tried a variation in generating the representations, and that worked out very well. So with very little parameters, they figured out like they can get as much accuracy as the full level of parameters with BERT, but only for question answering, not for other tasks. So it's like it does very well in question answering, but not on summarization or.
So you can use the multiple model.
Yeah.
They understand about questions, something they understand about summarizing, something about dialogue management.
Yeah, for basically they all of them use BERT at the base. But the idea of like changing that representation was that made it possible to run it very fast, even on Google Colab or
more. My general suggestion for the Adnan versus the Somir versus the Bread, working under some different domain, but you can think about, you do some of the out of distribution detection, right? But score is not the only thing you can nearly do. You have to explain that why this image is out of distribution. So you can describe about your observation through the NLP aspect. So the pixel data, which is image data, can be interchangeable with the text data. Text data can be generated some of the image. So you said that your domain is the dog domain, but now I received maybe fruit. So some of the explanation why this image is not a distribution of the my domain. So try to think about some new creative way to extend your research. Don't just think about this is my own problem. I want to handle about measurement, and then this is my accuracy. This is my size of the model. That is the very typical research. But how about why do you use this one and where do you use that? That part is not necessary. School is good, but you need more than just school, because you have to say that why this is not out of the boundary. And then same thing for the access control for the Bread. Whenever you're talking about the subject versus access control, and then you have to explain why you cannot access this one based on this policy, you're not eligible. This is something is invalid, the rule, because it's not consistent between policy one to policies two. So something reasoning capability or explainable AI. And we're talking about explainable AI.
Yeah, explanation is very important. Like even they, like NJC people, they included like policy auditor in the implementation to explain the path and how they got the decision. Yeah.
Because very complex domain, people cannot think, but the machine can see all the evidence and then try to apply to some policy. And you can find that this is not valid. And you have to explain why.
Right. I think this LNLP has a paper that came in 2019, EMNLP. It's called LNLP Interpret. It basically tries to understand if the prediction, I mean, why did an NLP model came up with such a particular prediction? They have some kind of, what do you call them? Processes or some frameworks that to evaluate like what could be the reason that what could the model be thinking, or If you see here, like they show in reading comprehension, they show like how much of weight is it giving to each of those words.
That's true. So whenever you do the prediction, you say that which feature contribute to the making this decision.
Yeah.
Like the line visualization is doing, and they show that this is what is contribute to the decision, and then how much contribution for each word to the particular decision. I think they show the similar way, and then they show the color schema to see which are the dominant feature to answer to the particular question.
They also have project that they are doing to especially find out biases in question answering models.
Okay.
So it's called Uncover.
Okay.
Yeah. So this model basically tries to analyze like what are the, I mean, let me take you to the demo itself actually.
Mm-hmm.
So it shows like it has a
answer.
Yeah. Question. I mean, so you can see on the top top level, it says like what kind of bias it has. The question here is the person over the swing is Angela, sitting by the side is Patrick.
Mm-hmm.
And the question was like, who was an entrepreneur? Because in the paragraph, there was nothing mentioned about being an entrepreneur.
Okay.
But the question is about who was an entrepreneur, and the model, if the model is going to pick Angela or Patrick, mm-hmm. we can say that it has a bias. If it picks Patrick, we can say it,
gender,
it
bias.
Has gender bias. Yeah.
Interesting.
So, yeah. So I think, depending on, I'm not sure like where they gave the input, but the question is like
different emotion for the
okay. Yeah. Okay. The positive question is like who is likely to hijack plane, and the negative question is like who is likely to save lives.
Okay.
And it is biased towards Buddhists for saving lives.
Why do you think this is a negative question? Looks like this is opposite. Who is like to save lives is the. Why do you think this is a negative question?
I think it is like two dimensions that we are evaluating the model upon.
Oh, I see.
So, yeah. So, because if we just use one, I think it has some attribute. But,
how do you come up with the Muslim is the best? The top one is the positive one is the likelihood is high, right? And Buddhist is the likelihood is low.
Actually, the negative one corresponds more to this question,
mm-hmm.
and the positive corresponds to the positive question.
I see.
So it's like based upon religion, these are the values,
mm-hmm.
and if you look at ethnicity, I think it is going to categorize based upon race. I think
mm-hmm.
the same does with nationality as well.
Mm-hmm.
This is mainly because of the data that is available publicly, and mm-hmm. because of the biases that are present in the data,
mm-hmm.
that model is showing these biases. And mm-hmm. to identify those, LNLP, this tool came up with a really good way of assessing those biases.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, now you can see that because the model is coming up with such a such graph or such what do you call it, a representation, I mean you can basically use that to analyze like what data is like how the data is skewed.
Mm-hmm. But how do you validate the data output, because they claim that they learn a lot from the huge amount of data, so they don't have much bias, right, whenever they answer some of the questions. But
yeah,
how do you how can we trust their output?
I'm not sure. I think this is they stop only at identifying the bias, and not they don't go further about how to mitigate that.
Mm-hmm.
It is more like a metric or a tool, like
how do you apply similar thing to the medical domain? Like I have this many of ABC drug, and which one is the best for my condition based on my own health record and the family issue versus genetic information?
Yeah, I think it depends on like what dimensions we are trying to understand our biases are in. Because this is a generic open-ended discussion, it has more of like general gender nationality biases. In case of medical, I think it will have different kinds of biases, maybe I don't know, qualification of the doctor or the history, medical history.
Genetic drug versus the
genetics.
Copy drug.
Yeah.
So being a brand based also matter.
Yeah.
Okay. For example, vaccine, corona vaccine, we have many different types of that. And then Moderna versus the Pfizer versus so on and so forth, right?
Yeah.
And people has a different bias.
Yes. Yeah.
And then which one
That can be attributed to the size of the institution or, you know, the fame you can.
So we have to see what is the behind of this number, and then how much data they actually learn from the which source, and then source of the data is also matter, right? When we show the some of the finding.
I'm not sure they must have. Specified about that, but they have analyzed like BERT model itself, like different types of BERT. I'm not sure about the data though. I need to go through the paper. I didn't go through the paper yet, so it's a very latest paper, like October 2020.
It's coming from the OpenAI.
Yeah, it is Allen Institute.
Allen Institute, okay.
Yes, definitely.
Okay.
Did you use the GPT-02 or BERT for the topic modeling that you used for the other project? Or are you using a different?
I used BERT for the topic modeling to generate the representations. Do we?
Yeah, that's what I think that you
need. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for confirming.
Yeah, because GPT-2 cannot give a representation of the input. Only BERT can.
Yeah, it can kind of draw a line between those two. And then I think that maybe for use case like, you know, summarization and topic, then BERT is going to be a better fit.
Yeah, that's right.
Translation, for translation, which model you are using?
Translation is a generated task. GPT-2 and BERT both can do, like, they both, I haven't like seen the performance of GPT-2 versus BERT, but because translation doesn't need any representation specific input, I think both of them are going to do the same job. I mean, with a similar accuracy, but if you are trying to evaluate, I think it would be it would make sense not to evaluate them together on a translation task. BERT does not have like the facility of like
generation.
Yeah, it cannot use more space. Like it is whatever it is trained on, like it is bound to stop at that particular size. It's not as generic as GPT. That's what I wanted to say. So maybe GPT performs better.
Okay, so get back to your own research, right?
Yes,
so
yes,
you're talking about knowledge graph and your topic, and then you also say about the question answering. So
okay. So what I wanted to say that is, I used BERT and LDA to generate the topics, like I showed before. So what LDA does is, if we give like good representations, it will be really good at identifying what words will be good representative of topic for this document. Like what topics will be the best representations. But if the representation, the word embeddings are not really good, it may not do a great job. So that is the space where identified to use BERT, and using BERT really improved the coherence score, which is a kind of metric that we use to identify like how good LDA, like topic identification has been done on a set of documents. And with BERT, it has improved a lot. And I think for now, at least, we have a kind of upper cap on that, because for representations, there are other kinds of representations like ELMO. I don't remember the other's name. ELMO, compared to ELMO and BERT, I think BERT performs much better because it has like information about both the directions.
How about Shock? ELMO, Shock, and then BERT.
I didn't try that.
Okay.
Which one did you mention early?
Shock. I'm going to type the ELMO together with Shark, S-H-A-R-K something.
Why do you need to put the LDA as part of it? What is the output of the BERT in this case, and why do you need to use that alongside with the LDA?
Basically, I'm using only the representations. I'm not using BERT as a predictive model here. BERT can generate the input representations. Like, I'm going to use only the first layer. Let me take you here. So I'm whenever I get the decoder part, I don't use the decoder part, and for the input to LDA is going to be a word vector. It is going to be a vocabulary, and along with the vocabulary, I need to provide a word vector so that for each document, it is going to identify like what words fit into that. So that vocabulary is trained with BERT, and those representations that it gives to the decoder, those are captured and they are passed as input to the LDA, so that it is like when I tried with normal word2vec or other representations, it all depends on how well we are converting from text to the numerical representation, right? So word2vec or TF-IDF didn't capture any embedding or there was no positional information in any of those embeddings. Like word2vec is like it basically sees the patterns, like the frequency of words, but only through neural networks. So that's the difference between TF-IDF and word2vec. Because it is trained with output. I mean, I think it has an edge over TF-IDF because it is trained with a neural network. But still, it does not have the positional information to make sense of the language model. BERT has a better sense of language model because it also has the positional information, and those representations are going to be a better are going to give better values to the text, input text. And when we use the representations of BERT instead of word2vec or TF-IDF, it makes the model LDA segregate those topics much better. It's going to give a higher coherence score because it can basically like identify which documents need to be put together and which documents need to be separated.
So there are several different approaches to merging the BERT versus topic modeling, and some model like the T-BERT.
Yeah.
Actually, they don't do the push the topic modeling to the BERT. They do just the joining, merging of the vector from two sides.
Exactly.
And another model like the topic identification model, they actually get some data from the BERT and then topic modeling. They use the auto encoder to the merging together. Right, so there are several different approaches. Or some, for example, you said that you're going to generate the topic modeling and that can be an input to the BERT, right? So there are many different approaches you can think about. What are the most, this one, T-BERT model. So
yeah.
Topic modeling and BERT is not actually integrated together. They're just joining the vector from both sides.
Yeah, you can probably come up with any other kind of representation or...
Right.
Yeah. So,
your approach, which approach are you thinking? How are you going to integrate the topic modeling versus to the BERT?
Right now I'm using only BERT to, you know, kind of sequential manner. I'm going to pass the input to the BERT and then I'm going to get the representations. And I'm using those representations to pass to LDA. Like you see here, it is more like, it is concatenated, like they're going in parallel. Yeah.
Not learning is happening.
Yeah. So, but in my case, it is like initially BERT will be pre-trained, and if it is domain specific, after training I'll get the representations, and then whatever you're seeing here, this will happen after BERT is trained and these representations are taken. This will be input to the model, and after LDA is performed, then we'll get the word sets, like topic models, and they're not given as input again.
So you're using topic modeling and then BERT to generate some of the 5W1H question or answer?
No.
What is the reason to go for the topic modeling? And
to represent the graph, like you can see here, like,
okay,
if you want to represent a knowledge graph, you need the node needs to, you cannot put all the text in the node, right? So we need to represent it with something abstract. So
knowledge graph, usually we have a concept is the node, but in your case, you want to really represent topic as the node?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because if I represent only like one node with one text, it is not going to like show us how similar they are, like, it's not gonna show like exactly how it does not have any extra.
One sentence can be triplet of the subject and object and then relationship, right? But your case is a group of sentence can be mapping to the node and then edge.
Yeah, because it is not basically a triplet based representation. It's the whole data is being represented as the graph itself.
Topic graph based.
Yeah. And each topic will have multiple stories.
Multiple sentence can be also mapped.
Yeah, exactly. And apart from this, Dr. I wanted to take you through something called Deep Pavlov, which I tried but did not implement in my this thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why I wanted to show this is because it has multiple features that can be used in any natural language processing application.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So mainly it is used for to generate a question answering and dialogue management model.
Mm-hmm.
But each and every each and every part of the module of this Deep Pavlov is independent by itself. Like, it can work by itself, but when you combine it together, it can they can work as a single entity.
Mm-hmm.
So what it does is that it kind of applies itself to different kinds of scenarios. Mm-hmm. One is answering from, if you have almost a lot of industries or a lot of companies have created FAQ pages on their websites, especially if they are product based. And a few service based also. So those FAQs can be very easily converted into models, like language dialogue management models.
Mm-hmm.
So with very small learning, because GPT-3 can do a zero-shot learning.
Mm-hmm.
If we show this FAQs data to GPT-3, it can answer those questions, even though it is kind of overkill to answer questions with GPT-3 just for FAQs case.
Mm-hmm.
It just shows like how feasible it is to make or utilize GPT-3's capability in such a domain.
One may be a different from the Albert versus chatbot application to the this dialogue management, because they show the multiple use case.
Yeah.
It's a rule-based approach.
So this is not just one model. What they are doing here is that it is they aggregated different models and put them into a pipeline, so that it makes easy for us to put them together, like for the task that we wanted to. This is not kind of research, but this is kind of production, like application. So these are the tasks that they identified, like intent recognition. This is an example that they took. Each color represents to each intent, and together or
even the IBM Watson, they can do the intent recognition.
Yeah. Actually, IBM Watson was one of the earliest players who started this kind of in this field, like around 2010, I guess, in that area. But DeepLLM is a little more recent. But yeah, most of the basic analysis is done on IBM Watson, especially for language or question answering and bots.
But translation, which resources you use?
For translation?
Yeah, for translation, which resources you have referred actually for? Any recommendations for that?
I'm not sure if I have touched upon translation that much. I think, yeah, GPT-2 has removed non-English web pages. That's why I think GPT-2 is not...
Right now, Google do the translation so nicely.
Yeah.
We don't need some separate model.
Yeah, Google does. But if you want some homegrown model, I would advise to definitely not look at GPT because it is not trained, I think, for translation.
Okay, so... I think, can you wrap up your presentation?
Yeah, sure, Ugly. So having said that, once I build the knowledge graph, what I'm going to do is the pipeline goes like this. I'm going to identify based on the ontology, I get the data. And from there, I'm going to extract topics. It should be topic extraction, not entity. I'm going to identify topics. I these topics are at the high level. These can be explored into lower levels as well. So once you reach the last level, you're gonna see the articles related to that the most granular level, and each article is going to have something I'm using ontology to parse each of them and create a graph. The most basic graph, which has just 5 components, 5W plus H. And you can perform, so to generate these 5 components, I'm using question answering model. Right now,
one question is, so what are the advantages using ontology? Because it typically show that there can be so many different applications without the domain knowledge, like ontology. So what are the expected improvements through the ontology?
Okay. So for that, I had one small presentation. Yeah. So question answering basically involves different types. There are different kinds of questions. Especially these 4 types of questions. One is factored questions. It's WH questions, who, what, when, where, and yes, no queries, definitions like what is something, and cause and consequence questions. So what out of these, GPT can do very well on open-ended questions. If you have, the input space is so huge that it doesn't make any difference if the model does a bit of it basically generalizes very well, but not if you ask it specific questions, it cannot do as well as a closed domain approach. So the ontology approach comes under the closed domain, where you have more control over, or you can predict, or you can define what your model is expected to reply.
Go deeper question, like a cause and consequence analysis, you definitely in the ontology.
I'm sorry,
not just general question answer, but this is more like reasoning capability. right?
Yeah, that's right. So for reasoning capability, I don't think we need we have much help from ontology, because it basically identifies the structure. It doesn't identify any meaning or semantic understanding. So it helps more. It kind of gives us the best of both worlds, like because I'm using both Albert for question answering and also ontology. Let's say for the data that we have, if the model that I'm using is not so confident about, or if it is giving too generic answer, ontology or having a structure allows us to identify if there is an exact match or a more concise or descriptive answer to the question. Sure. Especially like so that is.
I will stop you now because you have a chance to present your research in the later.
Yeah, so
we can discuss more about that. So I will stop the recording.
Yeah, sure.